Gatorade down like a spaghetti noodle. It's hiding warm.
You read a cockroach or a spider? A venomous spider.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to be with you, whether you're here in this space or streaming with us online. Next week, we will not be in this space. We will be across the street for another outdoor worship service. We hope you're able to join us. And I hope and trust that the weather will be a little warmer and a little brighter. A few notes about worship this morning. I'm actually going to, during our prayers, I'm going to restart doing something that I think y'all might be familiar with. And that is, during the prayers, I'm going to stop for a moment and say something along the lines of, we pray for those who we speak aloud or those who remain on our hearts. And we'll have a moment, and at that point, if you'd like to speak a name or a prayer that's on your heart, or if you simply like to pray for something or someone, there is space for that. And kind of lift up these prayers together all at once. And it's okay if we speak over each other, because all of our prayers are being lifted up to God. And it is a blessing. For those of you who were here last week, you might remember that we kind of did a question discussion at the end of the sermon period, and we're going to do that again today. So I'm going to have you do exactly the same thing and try to figure out right now who it is, the two or three people, groups of two or three, who you can talk about this question for a few minutes with. So. So go ahead and try to find that person now. Okay, you're starting to do it. That's good. So, now the real trick is then you have to look around you and see who might not have someone to talk to. So this is the part of welcoming other folks who might not be sitting with someone. Or who you might not know. So look around you. You might actually have to like turn your head. What a novel concept. See who's around you. Okay. So you've done that a little bit. So now, take your finger. Everybody put your finger in the air. We'll do this again. And now point to the person that you're talking to. So, if anybody still has their finger in the air, that's the person you need to connect with. Okay, very good. So, now we'll be ready when that time comes to have to start to tell some stories together and wonder together about what God might be up to. Are there any other? Debbie?
The food item we're collecting in August is peanut butter, jam, and jelly, and there's a box by the 5th Street door. So August, we're collecting peanut butter, jam, and jelly for the food shelf.
August, we're collecting peanut butter, jam, and jelly for the food shelf. I should say to the folks at home, I forgot to tell you this last week. So some of you might be worshiping in a room by yourself. So if you are, see if you can find a piece of paper, and while the rest of us are discussing, you can write. If you're not by yourself, talk to the people in the room. And I know it can be kind of awkward to get started. What you can do is just say, what do you think? What's going through your mind? What do you think? See what happens. Let us worship God together. Let's rest.
What food and what weather lies
lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us together confess our sin. God, our provider, help us.
It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways, but they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life.
Beloved people of God, hear the good news. The God of manna, the God of abundance, the God of new life, grants us new life in Christ. Friends, our sins are washed away. We are renewed completely and entirely in the name of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God,
your blessed Son came down from heaven to be the true bread that gives life to the world. Give us this bread always, that he may live in us, and we in him, and that strengthened by this food, we may live as his body in the world, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm reading from Ephesians 4, verses 22 through chapter 5, 2. We were taught to put away our former way of life, your old self, corrupt and deluded by its lusts, and to be renewed in the spirit of our minds, and to clothe yourselves with a new self, created according to the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that our words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you are marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath, anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to read responsibly Psalm 34, delivers them.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who take refuge in God.
Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. Then they said to him, and they began to complain about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They were saying, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say to us, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in the way has eternal life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of world is my flesh. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So we continue hearing both from the Gospel of John, and as we do, we continue to focus on the book of we looked together at the first half of the book of Ephesians, and we saw what God has done for us. And then I told you some of my stories. And in the last couple weeks, we've been looking at the second half of the book of Ephesians. Maybe you remember last week, what the things that come after the big therefore. These are the things that discipleship are all about. These are the things that come out of our baptism. So why am I asking you to start talking with each other? Why am I asking these questions of you and asking you to start to think of some stories? Well, I realized this past week when I was at a funeral where we told a lot of stories. This was kind of a storytelling family, and it was a real blessing to hear how folks remembered the stories that were told and told new ones, too. And it made me realize that stories, when we tell stories, when we hear stories, stories beget more stories. I've had a few people tell me in the last few weeks, you know, Seth, when you told that story about your life, that resonated with me, and that reminded me of when, and then they had a story to tell. Or maybe it was even just the beginning of a story, the beginning of something that might shape who they are and what they do. So stories beget more stories. And that's one reason why at the end of last week and at the end of this week's sermon, I ask you to start to tell some stories. It's not like I'm expecting you to have this like fully formed, shaped narrative. What happens though when we begin to think and to talk with one another is that I think the Spirit begins to move in our hearts. We begin to make connections. Connections with each other, connections in our stories. Because when we don't tell stories, then we miss those things. We miss the meaningful moments, the places where God has been at work in our lives, the places where God has been at work in our communities. We miss those nuggets of meaning. And as we tell our stories and as we hear others tell stories, we begin to pick up on them. We get new language, a new ability to see God at work, to find the meaning that is in our lives. And so, this is what we do. We tell stories. And this is actually something that Christians have done for thousands of years. And it's rooted in practices that go back even further. It's storytelling is a central Christian practice. So what about the Ephesians story this morning? Maybe you remember some of the shape of this book, of this letter. We began with the writer telling us how God has welcomed us, has claimed us, has made us God's own. That's what happens in baptism, too. And then the week after, we heard the story of how God broke down the dividing wall. How God has a real impact on our communities, just like God did 2,000 years ago when this was written. And then the week after, we heard God working through prayer. There was this powerful prayer from the writer for the Ephesians. And God moved in that prayer. Last week, then, we heard what came after the big therefore. There was this big therefore that shifted from the first half of the book that was primarily about what God has done for us into the second half of the book, which is not what we do for God, but what we do because of what God has done. What comes after the big therefore? And what comes after is a life that's full of meaning. Maybe you remember talking about callings. And our callings are things that are meaningful for us, that help us find meaning in our lives, that help us to be disciples. This week, we have a little bit of new language. And of course, it's 2,000 years old. But it's new for us in this book. And it says a little bit more about what baptism means for us. And so, I'd like to show you something. This is something that happens to us in baptism and then what comes after. So, in baptism, and I won't go far, in baptism, we are claimed by God. We are God's own. And then what comes after baptism, from the book of Ephesians, the writer tells us that we do something every day. And that is that we put on the new self. Now, you might be wondering why this kind of ghostly white robe was up here. And maybe you've seen one of these before. Kind of looks like a choir robe, and it kind of is. Maybe you've seen a pastor wear one of these things before. After we are baptized, what do? We put on the new self. Having been washed, we put on a new garment. And this garment, this is called an all. And pastors and church leaders and actually choirs sometimes wear things like this. And it's not to look big and fancy. It's these robes are a symbol of what happens here and what happens after. Because once we are baptized, we put on a new self. We put on the garment of baptism, having been washed in baptism. Ephesians tells us that we put away our old self and clothe ourselves with the new self. So there's our activity, it's our putting on the new self. And yet, even in this activity, God is there too. Because Ephesians also says that we are renewed, that God renews us. And that this new self, this new garment that we put on, well, God creates this new self out of baptism. So what is all of this really all about? I think this is about transformation. Transformation. Now, transformation is something that can be hard to see. And it can be something we can be pretty skeptical about. But I really believe that through baptism, the Holy Spirit begins to work on us, in us. The Holy Spirit, because we have put on this new self, because we have been baptized, the Holy Spirit begins to change us. And I don't think this is like some kind of easy, quick story. It's not a story where once our life was all terrible and now it is all great. It's not a story of once we were complete sinners and now we are completely new and different. It's a story of slow change. It's a story of transformation that happens from God and that we participate in. In baptism, God works on us. And in baptism, we turn towards our baptism. We put on the garment of new life. We put on the new transformation. And stories, when we tell stories, we are able to better see how this happens. We're better able to see how we've grown and changed. We're better able to see how God has shaped us. Here's a few ideas from the book of Ephesians. And I'm going to read it straight from the author's words. Here's a few ideas of the work that God does in us. From verse 25. So then, putting away all falsehood, let us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. I wonder, what might it mean for us in our fractured, divided world? What might it mean to speak the truth in a way that acknowledges our connectedness with one another? Here's thought number two. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. I wonder what it might mean to be angry and to express our anger without reacting out of the pit of it. I wonder. These are things that we grow into. And these are just a couple of examples of the ways in which God might shape us. God might help us grow. God might help us put on this new self. So here's the question for you. In the last year, maybe the last 2 years, what is one way that you think you might have changed? It's been a long and difficult couple of years. So what's one way that you think you might be different now than a year or two ago? This is your question for one of them. Go ahead.
Just to figure out. spend their own money, but it's very much that we already need to purchase things like that.
They're Lutheran, so you will need to reel them in when you do.
So then our job is not to make the change happen, but it's actually to turn towards the change that God is making in us. Let's rest in that. us together confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Loving God, for the church of Christ in all of its diverse forms, we pray for mission developers, for new mission starts, for missional seeds, and for all communities of faith exploring new ways of being God's people for the sake of the gospel. For congregations now facing difficult decisions about their future. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for the health and well-being of all creation. We thank you for rain, and we pray for trees that provide refuge from the hot summer sun. We pray for lakes and rivers, oceans and seas. We pray that we might care for all of creation. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those called to positions of authority in our legal system, for judges, lawyers, law clerks, and court employees who ensure that fair administration of justice is the case, for corrections officers and prison chaplains, we pray that they might deal mercifully with those who are incarcerated. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who cry out to you in their affliction, for exiles, refugees, and others who face long and difficult journeys, uncertain about the future, for all who mourn the death of a loved one, for all who are sick, especially Laura, Barry, Danny, Linda, Chuck, RJ, Jane, Julie, Paula, Eric, and all those who came before you now.
Laura, Cindy, Emily of Mary Kate Holmes,
Emily of Bobby Peterson,
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, we pray for all who grieve. We pray for those who have lost those close to them. We pray for places in the world being ravaged right now by COVID. Give them access, vaccines. Give them hope. Give them strength and courage. And give them a sense of your life, even in death. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We commune together by first opening the bread. If you need a set of communion, you have some. And if you're unfamiliar with our practice of communion in this speak the words of institution, and then as one we eat the bread, and then later as one we eat the cup, or we drink the cup. Hear this story, a story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. On the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks for it, and said to his disciples, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ, broken for you. And then after supper, our Lord Jesus took a cup, gave thanks for it, and said to his disciples, "This is the cup of the new covenant shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, remember me." The blood of Christ shed for you. Gathered in one by the Holy Spirit, let us together pray as Jesus Christ.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Caroline. It's still fun, isn't it?